We are going to discuss the chemical reactions and chemical reactors, followed by the introduction to the water treatment and coagulation as well. So moving on to the chemical reactions which occur in the different chemical processes, we use water treatment as a tool to make our drinking water a safe water for the drinking purposes. But to achieve the safe drinking water, there are certain chemical processes which occur in the treatment plant or the purification plant, and we must know the types of reactions, and these types are the general types of the chemical reactions which occur in different chemical reactions, but at the same time these occur in the water treatment as well. So here we go with the basic reaction types. The type 1 reaction is the combustion reaction, which is quite similar reaction, and we all know that a combustion reaction occurs when stuff burns. Combustion reactions take place when a compound containing carbon and hydrogen reacts with oxygen to make water vapor, carbon dioxide and heat. So we don't burn anything in water treatment, definitely, but as we are discussing the types of reactions, so we would be discussing all the types which are common and very basic reaction types. So some of the reaction types would be used in water treatment. Consider the general form of a combustion reaction is the hydrogen containing compound, when in the presence of oxygen burns, it results as carbon dioxide and water. One example of combustion takes place when cyclohexane, which is present in crude oil, is burned, and it results in the form of carbon dioxide and water molecule. The other type of chemical reaction is synthesis reaction. A synthesis reaction is a reaction in which simple compounds are combined to make a more complex one. The general form is to combine two simpler molecules in the form of a complex molecule. Example occurs when sodium and chlorine gas combine to make sodium chloride, which is the basic chemical reaction, and we all know that since 8th or 9th grade. Then comes the reaction type number 3, decomposition reaction. The decomposition reaction is also very important in environmental engineering, in terms of wastewater treatment, in terms of compost, in terms of biogas, in terms of other contamination causing molecules which need to be degraded or decomposed through different chemical processes, physical processes, thermal processes, or biological processes. So a decomposition reaction is one where a molecule, where a complex molecule breaks apart into simpler ones. The general form is, again, the complex molecule has been broken down into the two simpler molecules. Occurs when hydrogen peroxide breaks apart to form oxygen gas and water. It's once again very simple example. The fourth type of reaction is the single displacement reaction. It occurs when a pure element switches places with an element in a chemical compound. Essentially, two atoms switch places. The general form is A plus BC is equal to B plus AC. It is also a very common type of redox reaction. Magnesium into hydrochloric acid, when converted, it is called as the single displacement reaction. Then double displacement reaction, it occurs when the cations of two chemical compounds switch places. The general form again is the one in which both the molecule are changing their elements or atoms into one another, in which you can see that A and C switched places. If you were for some reason interested in adding hydrochloric acid to silver nitrate, you would see that the following double displacement reaction occurs, and silver chloride will eventually degrade in light to form silver metal and chloride gas. Then we have the acid-base reaction, which is once again, which is a very common reaction. In any case, acid-base reactions are pretty much the same thing as double displacement reactions, except that water is one of the things that's made. It's quite similar to the double displacement chemical reaction, but the product is water in acid-base reaction, which makes the difference between acid-based reaction and double displacement chemical reactions. It occurs when nitric acid is neutralized with sodium hydroxide and it results as sodium nitrate and water. These were the six types of chemical reactions. I would like to repeat all these: combustion reactions, synthesis reactions, decomposition reactions, single displacement reactions, double displacement reactions, acid-base reactions. All these six chemical reactions are the basic categories of chemical reactions, and now we would be moving to the chemical reactors in which these chemical reactions, most of these chemical reactions occur, or we intend to conduct such chemical reactions in such type of chemical reactors. There are different types of chemical reactors. It is an enclosed volume in which a chemical reaction takes place. It's just like a vessel which is enclosed or airtight vessel. The design of a chemical reactor deals with multiple aspects like maximize net present value for the given reaction. For example, you want to achieve maximum efficiency from a reaction, then you have to make the ideal reactor to conduct the chemical reaction in a very efficient way. Ensure that the reaction proceeds with the highest efficiency. Lower the amount of money to purchase and operate. Normal operating expenses include energy input, energy removal, raw material costs, labor, etc. Energy changes can come in the form of heating or cooling, pumping to increase pressure, frictional pressure loss or agitation. There are various technical aspects which can be kept in mind while designing, fabricating and installing a chemical reactor for the chemical reactions. So we'll look at the geometry and the design of the chemical reactor depending upon the chemical reaction which has to be occurred in this chemical reactor or in any chemical reactor. So we must be very careful while designing the chemical reactors. It must fulfill the needs of the chemical reaction. If it fulfills the needs of a chemical reaction, then it would be providing the maximum efficiency which is possible during that chemical reaction. First type of chemical reactors is batch reactor. This type of reactor is a batch reactor. Materials are loaded into batch reactor and the reaction proceeds with time. A batch reactor does not reach a steady state and control of temperature, pressure and volume is often necessary. Many batch reactors therefore have ports for sensors and material input and output. Batch reactors are typically used in small scale production and reactions with biological materials. I would like to share a chemical reactor with you, which is the batch reactor again, and it had all the things which are being discussed over here. Let me extract the picture of that chemical reactor, which was designed and fabricated by your juniors, your seniors. All right, yes. For example, here we have mentioned that a batch reactor does not read the steady state condition. That means it must be controlled by someone so that the chemical reaction can be controlled. because it the chemical reactor which is being discussed over here cannot reach the steady state condition itself, and the temperature control is a must thing in that chemical reactor. Pressure, if it is using high pressure, then that control must be able, and the person who is conducting the research or reaction can must arrange something to control the pressure. Its volume must be sufficient for the chemical reaction, and all these parameters were kept in mind in this chemical reactor. You can see that it's a batch reactor. It was designed by 15 students, and you can see the pressure gauge over here to control the pressure. You can see pressure regulator to control, once again to regulate the pressure. You can see the temperature sensor over here. This is a temperature sensor to sense and control the temperature. This insulation is to, while we were discussing the heating energy changes come in the form of heating or cooling. We were discussing these two things. So energy change, here we need maximum energy. So if we do not provide the insulation, additional insulation across the chemical reactor, around the chemical reactor, then the energy change would be faster as compared to the reactor with insulation. So we have provided or arranged insulation over here. There is a heating coil which is providing heat. It is considered as the heat source. Then outside cover or the body, a closed vessel for the chemical reactor. Then inner cylinder, this is the place where the chemical reaction had to take place. And then there were some other valves and bolts for normal control. So it is a perfect example of batch reactor. I'm discussing this reactor with you that so that you can understand that it had been designed at the department, and it had been operated by the departmental students. You can see the design of this chemical reactor and all the parameters which were being discussed in the lecture are also incorporated in this design. And then if you go to the fabrication process, while you visit the market and select the material for the chemical reactor, and then you select the vendor or the supplier who can fabricate that reactor or who can manufacture that reactor for you, then you can get manufactured reactor for your chemical reaction. And this was the chemical reactor. You must have seen this chemical reactor in my office as well, if you have visited my office. This is the chemical reactor. This chemical reactor, you can see the pressure gauges, valves, control boards, and the closed vessel. And you have also seen the chemical requirements of this chemical reactor in terms of its vessel, in terms of its design, and in terms of its insulation as well. So this was the design of the same chemical reactor, and here we have the actual chemical reactor which was operated for the conversion of biological or your domestic solid waste into the coal-like product, which is called as biochar or hydrochar. And the basic concept of making this chemical reactor was to conduct their final year project. They have completed the thesis, and you can see the final product of that project as well. this was like coal like product, and it has more energy as compared to the input energy. The comparison between the input and output energy was almost around 1.27, and there is still a possibility of improving the efficiency of that material. We can change the feedstock or the raw material which was used in terms of making this coal like product. So this was their FYP. We are discussing the BAS reactor, and I have all of a sudden I recall that I had an opportunity to supervise a thesis with BAS reactor as well. That's why I shared with you. Then comes the continuous stirred tank reactors. These are the opposite to the BAS reactors. In a CSTR, one or more fluid reagents are introduced into a tank reactor, which is typically stirred with an impeller, or if it is a very like big chemical reactor, then you can install different turbines to agitate the agents or the constituents of chemical reaction to ensure proper mixing of the reagents while the reactor effluent is removed. In batch reactor, we had just a simple reaction which was being controlled by the chemical by different aspects. But in continuous reactor, we keep adding constituents for the chemical reaction, and at the same time we keep removing the effluent after the completion of chemical reaction. Dividing the volume of the tank by the average volumetric flow rate through the tank gives the space time or the time required to process one reactor volume of fluid. It is just like to calculate the hydraulic retention time or detention time of the chemicals or the fluid which was fed to the chemical reactor for the occurrence of chemical reaction. You must know, or you must calculate, you must design the time in which the chemical reaction would be completed, and that time would be called as the detention time of the fluid in the reactor. And after that, the fluid must be removed as an effluent from the reactor so that it can fulfill the condition of its being as a continuous stirred tank reactor. Like, it must be in a continuous flow rather than in a batch flow. At steady state, the mass flow rate is must equal to the mass flow rate out. At steady state, the incoming mass flow must be equal to the effluent, so that you can manage or you can fulfill the condition of its continuity. The reaction proceeds at the reaction rate associated with the output. Often it is economically beneficial to operate several CSTRs in series. This allows the first CSTR to operate at a higher reagent concentration and therefore a higher reaction rate. If we simply recall a point to remember the properties of CSTR, there must be a design of chemical reaction and the time at which the chemical reaction between those fluids would be occurring must be calculated, and the inflow must be designed or optimized according to the detention time, so that the chemical reactor must remain in the steady state condition, the influent must be equal to the outfluent, and the total volume of fluid inside the tank must remain constant to make the continuity of its being continuous stirred tank reactor. These are the impellers to mix the reagents. It's a very like big reactor for, it might be for some industrial purposes rather than for the research purposes. The stirred tank reactor in which the impellers are like induced or installed to make it homogenize or homogeneously mixed the chemical reagents inside the reactor. You can see that it's also a airtight reactor, and it can be like very satisfying that the flow and outflow are from a single channel rather than we witness any leakages or the loss of the reagents from different points. So it must be airtight, it must be moisture tight, it must be liquid tight, so that the chemical reaction can occur at the best efficiency. Then comes the plug flow reactor. After CSTR, then comes the plug flow reactor. In a plug flow reactor, one or more fluid reagents are pumped through a pipe. The chemical reaction proceeds as the reagents travel through the plug flow reactor. In this type, the changing reaction rate creates a gradient with respect to distance. At the inlet to the PFR, the rate is very high, but as the concentrations of the reagents decrease and the concentration of the products increase, the reaction rate slows down. Some important aspects of the PFR discussed below. One thing must be clarified, they have discussed or explained in terms of its concentration gradient. It's just like ke aap log jab kisi bhi jagah pe koi dekhte hain, concentration dekhte hain kisi bhi pollutant ki, for example, by the time it travels towards any direction, to uski jo concentration hai wo utilize ho ke कम होती जा रही होती है, ठीक है. और बाय द टाइम इट्स कॉन्सेंट्रेशन डिक्रीजेस, द कॉन्सेंट्रेशन ऑफ द प्रोडक्ट्स इंक्रीजेस. तो जिस चीज में वो कन्वर्ट हो रहे हैं तो ऑब्वियसली उसकी कॉन्सेंट्रेशन बढ़ जाती है, ऑल दो वो न्यूट्रल हो या वट एवर इज द रिएक्टेंट प्रोडक्ट, तो उसकी कॉन्सेंट्रेशन बढ़ जाती है. उसके अलावा अब कुछ चीजें जो हैं वो एक दो पॉइंट इन्होंने केमिकल रिएक्टर्स के हवाले से बता दिए. प्लग फ्लो रिएक्टर के द आइडियलाइज प्लग फ्लो रिएक्टर मॉडल अज्यूम्स नो एक्सियल मिक्सिंग. एनी एलिमेंट ऑफ फ्लूइड ट्रेवलिंग थ्रू द रिएक्टर डज नॉट मिक्स विद फ्लूइड अपस्ट्रीम और डाउनस्ट्रीम फ्रॉम इट एज इम्प्लाइड बाय द टर्म प्लग फ्लो. तो प्लग फ्लो में जब आप मूव कर रहे हैं, आप यहाँ पे देखें, ये आपको पॉइंट यहाँ पे जरा ज्यादा समझ आएगी कि प्लग फ्लो रिएक्टर में जब आपका बैच मूव कर रहा है फ्रॉम लेफ्ट टू राइट, ठीक है, तो ये जो चीज़ है इसमें केमिकल रिएक्शन आकर करेगा, या ये जो आपकी पोल्यूशन है या केमिकल रिएक्ट पोल्यूशन ना आप केमिकल रिएक्टर समझें इसको, तो केमिकल रिएक्शन ये जो केमिकल रिएजेंट्स हैं, रिएक्टेंट्स हैं, ये इस तरफ भी अपस्ट्रीम भी मूव नहीं करेंगे, डाउनस्ट्रीम भी मूव नहीं करेंगे रिएक्शन के लिए. वैसे तो ये मूव कर रहा है लेकिन इसका जो केमिकल रिएक्शन है वो इसकी विसिनिटी में ही रहेगा. लाइक इसकी जो जो एक एक इसका बफर डेवलप हो जाएगा जहां तक इसकी केमिकल रिएक्शंस आकर करेंगे, उसको एक प्लग कह देंगे आप. और उसी प्लग का जो फ्लो है दैट इज कॉल्ड एज प्लग फ्लो रिएक्टर, ठीक है. तो ये भी क्लोज वेसल है लेकिन इसमें आप फ्रॉम वन साइड टू द अदर साइड जो केमिकल रिएक्शन आकर करवाते हैं और उसमें एज ए प्लग फ्लो जो है वो आपका केमिकल रिएक्शन आकर करता है. सेकेंड पॉइंट इज रिएजेंट्स मे बी इंट्रोड्यूस इन टू अ प्लग फ्लो रिएक्टर एट इन द रिएक्टर अदर देन द इनलेट. इन दिस वे अ हायर एफिशंसी मे बी ऑब्टेन्ड और द साइज एंड कॉस्ट ऑफ द पी एफ आर मे बी रिड्यूस्ड. तो अब यहाँ पे वो कह रहे हैं कि केमिकल रिएक्शन को आकर करने के लिए जो केमिकल रिएजेंट्स हैं वो जरूरी नहीं है कि वो यहाँ से स्टार्ट हों. अगर आपको किसी स्टेज पे अगर उसमें कुछ ऐड करना है तो आप वो भी उसमें ऐड करने की प्लग फ्लो रिएक्टर की एबिलिटी है, करैक्टरिस्टिक है कि ये किसी भी जगह पे आप केमिकल रिएजेंट्स इसमें ऐड कर सकते हैं टू मैक्सिमाइज योर एफिशिएंसी, टू मैनेज योर केमिकल रिएक्टर एफिशिएंटली. And then the third point is a plug flow reactor has a higher theoretical efficiency than a CSTR of the same volume. That is, given the same space time or residence time, a reaction will proceed to a higher percentage completion in a plug flow reactor than in a CSTR. This is not always true for reversible reactions. It was the comparison between the two chemical reactors, CSTR and PFR. Then comes the semi-batch reactor. A semi-batch reactor is operated with both continuous and batch inputs and outputs. Then comes the catalytic reactor. Although catalytic reactors are often implemented as plug flow reactors, their analysis requires more complicated treatment. The rate of the catalytic reaction is proportional to the amount of catalyst the reagents contact as well as the concentration of the reactants. The behavior of the catalyst is also a consideration. Catalytic reactors are those in which the catalysts are being used, and these can be of any design from the reactors which we have discussed earlier, but we use catalytic behavior of some catalyst, so we must be thinking about its efficiency as well, so that the chemical reaction may take place in a very favorable condition depending upon the catalyst behavior. A common example of a catalytic reactor is the catalytic converter that precedes toxic components of automobile exhaust. However, most petrochemical reactors are catalytic and are responsible for most industrial chemical production, with extremely high volume examples including sulfuric acid, ammonia, reformate, BTEX, benzene, toluene, ethyl benzene and xylene. And fluid catalytic cracking. Various configurations are possible. See heterogeneous catalytic reactors. So this was all about the chemical reactors and chemical reactions which occur during the chemical research and development. We must know, or we must recall all these things at a single stage, as we have to use some chemical reactions in water treatment as well, in terms of coagulation, in terms of disinfection of the treated water, and in terms of providing the residual chlorine to the water. So we must know all the chemical reactions and the chemical reactors in which these chemical reactions occur. These are very basic points in terms of chemical reactions, and we must know all the types of chemical reactions and all the types of chemical reactors to further proceed with the with our basic knowledge. I would like to move further. Let me take a call as well. Ji, walaikum assalam.